Chris Scott here, the young adult ministry leader. Got a couple announcements for you this morning. So happy you're here. Sign-ups out in the Welcome Center in the Narthex for our senior adult trip. It's coming up. Also, we have a women's paint class coming up on April 16th. And then April 26th, we have the senior game night, and you can sign up for that as well. It's out front. Listen, we're looking for some teachers, some folks that have the heart and ministry to join in and teach kids in the Joy Zone or just be there and help out on Sunday morning during our Sunday school. If you would, please, see Clark Goble if you're interested in that. We'd love to have you there. Baby dedications are coming up for Mother's Day. The forms are in the Joy on the Go locations. Just stop in there and fill that out to have your baby dedicated on Mother's Day. Also coming up is our graduation celebration, and those forms are in the Joy on the Go as well. You can stop in and fill one of those out for your graduate. Some dates you need to put on your calendar, some upcoming events. On April 18th, women's paint class, 6 to 9 p.m. here at the church. Make sure you're signed up for that up front. April 19th, the Mommy and Me. It's at 10 a.m. Just a great time to get out of the house, you and your little one, just to get out and fellowship with some of the ladies here. On April 20th is our Saturday morning men's prayer breakfast. It's at the Golden Corral at 8 a.m. If you have not been to this, you need to come. Invite each and every one of you men to come out, enjoy fellowship, and listen, there's a lot of bacon ate at that thing every Saturday morning that we have that. That's on April 20th at 8 a.m. On April 21st, we've got a youth event, and Daphne's going to be giving us all the details of that coming up. April 24th is a quarterly business meeting. And then April 26th is that senior game night. Man, that's what a blast they're going to be having. Lots of different things going to be going on that evening. That's at 5:30 on April 26th, our senior game night. And then on April 28th, you'll be able to come and hear some amazing voices as we praise the Lord with our voices, making a joyful noise at the Songfest. And that's at 6 p.m. on April 28th. Thanks again for joining us here today at Real Joy. Real people, real joy. Get ready. Let's worship.
If you're visiting today, you are welcome here. Let's sing, church.
It's crowded in worship today. As she slips in, trying to fade into the faces, the girl's teasing laughter is carrying farther than the body. Why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't my feet going? Why is his love not showing? Then there is a way.
Here we go.
There is a way.
This is the way.
Why aren't his hands healing? Jesus is the way.
Jesus is the way, Jesus is the truth, and Jesus is the life. Your time of fellowship, turn around and wave to somebody. Tell them good morning, we're glad you're here.
And if we are the body, why aren't His arms reaching? Why aren't His hands healing? Why aren't His words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't His feet going? Why is His love not showing? Then there is a way.
Sing it again.
But if we are the body, why aren't His arms reaching? Why aren't His hands healing? Why aren't His words reaching? And if we are the body, why aren't His feet going? Why is His love not showing? If there is a way,
Jesus is the way. You believe that? Let me hear you say amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Jesus is the way. Amen. You are welcome here. You are welcome here. So listen, we're a couple of weeks past Easter when we celebrated the resurrection of Jesus. The stone was rolled away. Jesus came out. And the rest is history. Jesus is alive today. There wasn't a grave that would hold Him down. And someday for this guy, there ain't no grave gonna hold me down. Come on, Dash, sing.
Fear is a tower, it's always telling me to run. Oh,
Love and appreciate them and everything they do with the youth. But listen, there's all kind of voices out there. There's chatter everywhere. We hear things that are good of God, and then the devil jumps on the other shoulder and tells us lies, tells us we're defeated, tells us we're not good enough. Listen, Jesus is the voice of truth. Jesus is the voice of truth. Amen. Oh, what I would do to have the kind of faith it takes to climb out of this boat I'm in and onto the crashing waves, to step out of my comfort zone, to the realm of the unknown where Jesus is. He's holding out his hand, but the waves are calling out my name and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the times I've tried before in prayer. The waves keep on telling me time and time again, boy, you'll never win, you never win.
is speaking today. And oh, what I would do to have the kind of strength it takes to stand before a giant with just a sling and a stone, surrounded by the sound of a thousand warriors shaking in their armor, wishing they'd have had the strength to stay. But the giant's calling out my name and he laughs at me, reminding me of all the times I tried before and failed. The giant keeps on telling me time and time again, boy, you'll never win, you'll never win. But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says do not be afraid. And the voice of truth says this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out to me, I would choose to listen and believe the voice. The snow was just the right size to put the giant on the ground. And the waves, they don't seem so high from on top of them looking down. I will soar with the wings of eagles when I stop and listen to the sound of Jesus singing over me. But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says do not be afraid. And the voice of truth says this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out, I would choose to listen and believe the voice of truth. I will listen and believe, I will listen and believe the voice of truth. I will listen and believe, 'cause Jesus, you are the voice of truth. I will listen and believe, I will listen and believe the voice of truth. Listen. I will listen and believe, 'cause Jesus, you are the voice of truth. Speak now, Jesus. I will listen and believe, I will listen and believe the voice of truth. I will listen and believe, 'cause Jesus, you are the voice of truth. I will listen and believe, I will listen and believe the voice of truth. Jesus is the voice of truth. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Good job. Good job. Good job. He is here today. And in case you don't know it, or Satan has tried to tell you otherwise, Jesus loves you. He loved you enough to willingly be sacrificed on a cross for you. For you. The Bible says, scarcely will one die for a righteous man, that God commended his love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, he sent his son Jesus to die for us. That's you, and that's me, and that's all of us. He loves you. If we could have some ushers come forward, we'll continue to worship in our giving. Appreciate everyone that's here today. If you're visiting for the first time, I hope you got a visitor's packet. You can slip that visitor's card right into the offering plate. We'd love to get to know you better and have you become part of our Real Joy family.
Let's pray. Father, we love you. You are here today. Your word says where two or three are gathered together, you will be in the midst. And Jesus, you are here. You know our hearts. You know our minds. You know everything about us, Jesus. And as we take this time now to worship you with what you've blessed us with, our tithes and our offerings and our Operation Joy commitments, Jesus, take them, multiply them, and use them for the upbuilding of your kingdom as we work to fulfill the Great Commission, Jesus. Go ye therefore. We love you. We give you praise and honor. In your name we pray. So that I'm not so redundant, because I am a Jesus freak. But let me just say, maybe you're more of the quiet type. If you love Jesus, I want a great big smile, the biggest one you've got. The teens are pouting on the front two rows. Amen. We win this thing when it all's said and done. We win this thing. So we've got a special treat this morning. Rayetta's over here, and she leads our drama ministry. And so I'll let her introduce what's about ready to take place.
Somebody they know. I think you might know him too. His name is Jesus.
Great job. Great job. Come on, bump me. Good job, all of you. Good job.
I guess you can't plan for everything. Somebody hit the keyboard, so we got a little extra.
So actually, I've seen when she leaned back and hit a button, and I thought, oh no. But I don't know if you noticed or how rhythmic you are, but it was actually with the same beat as the song. So I don't know, it added some more emphasis to it, to the resurrection of Jesus. Proud of our kids, they did a great job, didn't they? Come on, Pastor.
Children can be dismissed. I can say one thing, that even though the keyboard got hit, they didn't slow down, did they? They stayed right on point. They were focused. If that didn't move you, I don't know what will. You know, the cool thing is we have teens that are given their talents to the Lord. And they could have been backward and said, I'm not going to do this. Or they could have just said, no, I'm too cool for that. But thank you, brother. Appreciate it. But they were right there, and I appreciate them. I told Miss Daphne last week, I said, girl, that baby's going to come out of there either singing or swinging, one of the two. Softball, you know, back. I said, it's coming out. It's going to be going on, I tell you. That's amazing. Randy, you make sure all of them know that they did a fantastic job. Okay? Make sure that you tell them. And Ray, you did all right. Yeah. That's my sister. She did good, giving up her time and her talents doing that. That was amazing. And I knew all the scenes, and it was exciting to see every one of them being a part of it. It's good. Good. Hey, I want to open up in prayer, and we're going to jump into this. I'm excited about what God's doing. So let's pray. Father God, I come to you right now to thank so much for the power of prayer. And Father, as we come to you today, we ask you to speak to our hearts, speak to our minds, God. It is all about you. And I thank you for those teens giving up their time and their talents for you and not being ashamed of the gospel of Christ. And so, God, we just thank you so much for them. Thank you for our praise band, God, just leading us in worship, taking us right to the very throne of God so that we can worship you in spirit and truth. But God, today as we open up your word, we ask you to speak to our minds and our hearts. Father, help us to receive your word, not just to just hear, hearers only, but to be doers of your word and to apply it to our very lives. God, we love you and we thank you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you're visiting with us today, we do this every Sunday. I say, if you got your sword and you're ready to go into battle, I thought the keyboard was getting ready to go off again. I said, I'm not singing. All right. Man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word proceeds out of the mouth of God. Now, I ask you that, and every week we say, yeah, we do that. Come on in, guys. You're not going to hurt anything. Yeah, I haven't started yet. Yeah. Yes, sir. We appreciate all of you. I ask you that every week. I said, do you guys believe that? And you go, yeah. But you know, there's one thing just to hear it. It's another thing to actually hear it and apply it to your life. Take it in and soak it up and use it. So I'm not up here just to waste my breath. It is for you to grow in the Lord so that when you walk out of here, you're equipped for the battles that you're going to face every day. Every day. And if you're not in a spiritual battle, like I said last week, you're either just come out of one, getting ready to go into one, or you're right in the middle of one. Get ready. It's coming. So go ahead and take your Bibles and turn to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. We've been walking through the book of Ephesians verse by verse and chapter by chapter. And we're getting to the final parts. And what Paul is telling us, he says that Christians need to do these final things. This is what I'm giving. This is the final words that I'm giving you. And you need this as a Christian to live a victorious Christian life. Did you hear me say that? A victorious Christian life. Not one of struggle, but a victorious Christian life. I cannot count the number of people who told me last week, "Pastor, I got to tell you, that sermon was for me." Last week, and we're talking about the armor of God, "Pastor, that was for me." Well, I appreciate you telling me that. And if you weren't here last week, go on Facebook or onto our website and watch it. You will not be disappointed, because it is for you as well. Not just me, it's for you. When I preach to you, I got all these fingers pointing right back to me. And so I'm preaching to me, and I want to have a victorious Christian life. I don't like to lose anything. Pull up beside me at a stoplight, you'll see. All right. That would be illegal, wouldn't it, Brad? No, that's what I thought. Confession is good for the soul, but bad for the reputation. I've had several peeling and squealing tickets, just to be honest with you. That's not a good thing. I thought it was funny at the time. Spiritual battle. So, if you remember last week, I said when we read these scriptures, I said if you see the word "stand firm," to underline them, to highlight them. We're going to read that again today. Do that as well. But also, I want you to do that with the full armor. Full armor. So that you know that you're not just supposed to put on part of the armor, but the full armor. Look at verse 13, because when Paul repeats something over and over again, he's trying to drive a point home. Think about how many times you tell your children, "How many times I got to tell you to clean up your room, clean up your room, clean up your room. Did you take out the trash? Did you take out the trash?" You feel like a broken record, don't you? Paul's trying to drive something home to us. And look at verse 13. Look what it says. "Therefore," remember what we say when you see the words "therefore," make sure you find out why it's "there for." "Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you'll be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm." So we found out what it's there for real quick, didn't we? "Therefore, take up the full armor of God," not part of it, not none of it, all of it, or whole armor, depending on what your translation says. "Take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist." That's why it's there for. If you take on the full armor of God, you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Paul reminds us again and again to take up the full armor of God. And if you got your outline with you today, the first one on your outline, as a Christian, we need to be fully equipped in the armor of God to resist in the day of evil. To resist in the day of evil. We got to wear it all. Teens, I got to tell you, sometimes I don't understand how in the middle of wintertime you're wearing shorts and a hoodie. You're throwing me off there. Which one is it? Is it cold, hot, whatever? All right. I want the full armor. I want the long johns. So, resist in the evil day. What's the evil day? What is the evil day? Is today the evil day? How about tomorrow? How about yesterday? Here's the next one on your outline. Paul says to resist an evil day. Any day that you are attacked by the devil's schemes and you are faced with something evil is the evil day. Any day. That could be today. It's amazing, Christians, how many times we get in the car and go down the road and we are tempted and we say to ourselves when we fail, "Boy, that didn't last very long now, did it?" today could be the evil day. It could be tomorrow. It could have been yesterday. It could have been 10 years from today. Back 10 years when you wish you had on the whole armor of God, but you were defeated. You come under attack and you didn't have on the full armor of God, and so you failed at that very moment. It could be any day that you come under attack is an evil day. Paul tells us to be prepared. Be prepared. If you look at that verse 13 again, look what it says there. Be prepared. Be able to resist an evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Everything. A lot of times Christians want drive-through relationship with God. We just want to drive through just when we need to pick up something quick. And what we need to do, we need to go in and sit down. We need to go to have a sit-down dinner with him. We need to go in there and sit down, and we need to be prepared in the evil day. And that writing there, when Paul says that, says you need to be prepared, because at any time that evil day could happen. Doing everything to stand firm. The wording says something like this. Brian and Daphne own the Paper City, CrossFit Paper City. Yeah, I'm not CrossFit. I'm not even fit. Sometimes I'm fit to be tied, but I'm not fit. Do you know at the beginning of January, New Year's Eve, that the gym memberships pick way up? Today I'm going to get fit. It's going to happen this week, this year. It's going to be a new year. 2024 is my year, baby. I'm going to work out. I'm going to get pumped. We're here to pump you up, okay? My day, you guys don't understand that, but we're here to pump you up. And we're worried about physical physique. My son Jeremy, he's all into this eating right, and he gets on me every time he sees me eat Reese cups. And Dad, that's not good for your diabetes. I know, son. Hey, you shouldn't be eating that. I know. As I'm cramming a pizza in, you know. He's into that. He gets up at 3:30 in the morning to go work out. I said, "You're an overachiever." Nah, not going to do it. I'm glad he's in shape because it reminds me that I probably can't take him right now. But anyway, but here's the thing. I'm glad people work out. I really am glad. If you see me running, Tracy, right? If you see me running, you better run, and something's chasing us. So... If you're visiting, I have ADHD, and it just comes to me. I went to go visit the doctor, have my knee replaced. I went in there and I asked him, because Clark was asking me. I said, "Hey, can I run on this new knee?" He goes, "Why?" He said, "You're 60 years old." I said, "Maybe a dog's chasing me. Maybe the guy's bigger than me, and I need to run." But people like to get in shape. We have a run and walk with God, right? Be picking back up now that the weather's starting to change. And my question is this. Gym memberships, eating right, working out, pumping iron, all that stuff. I'm going to run a 5K. I'll watch people run a 5K. My question is, do we ever work out spiritually? You know, Paul's talking here about having done everything. It's hard to fight a spiritual battle when you're not coming in to work out. Hebrews says, "Forsake not the gathering of the saints, encouraging one another until that day draws near." We should all be in here worshiping together. I want to take it a little further. How many of you are doing a home workout? You see, if you want to do everything you can to get ready for that evil day so that you can stand firm, you need to be putting on the full armor of God, and you need to be working out. Work out the spiritual side of your life. Get into God's word. That's why I'm saying I'm not up here preaching just to hear myself talk, although some of you might think that. I really don't do that. I tell you, I'm trying to teach you what God's word says so when you walk out these doors, you can live a Christian victorious life. I tell you, Christ doesn't want you to fail. He's already won the victory. Remember what I said last week? You're not fighting for a victory. You're fighting from victory. Sin's already been defeated. You do not have to lose. But as long as we're in this body, we're going to struggle with that. We're going to struggle with that. So, like I said, I like to win. My wife would get on me. Valerie, she's such a sweetheart. She want to always play checkers. And we play checkers, and I'd never let her win. And Trisha, she'd just get mad. She'd say, "Why don't you let her win every once in a while?" I said, "You never win. You never learn anything by always winning. You got to get smarter. You got to learn strategy." Well, she's pretty smart now. She's smarter than Dad. And she's taking them psychology classes. She'd send me, "Dad, I figured out what's going on with you." She's got her degree in psychology, and I was a test subject. But anyway. But hey, listen. You need to know what Satan's strategies are. Doing everything you can to stand firm. Stand your ground. Today we're going to start looking at different pieces of the armor. And look at the first piece of armor right here. Go back to your Bible, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 14. Look what it says here. Stand firm. There it is again. Stand firm, driving it home, Paul. I got your point. Therefore, having girded your loins with truth. That's the first piece of armor that you need to have. And actually, they're talking about the belt of truth. The belt of truth. Now, Clark, our director of education, I was reading in one of the commentaries. I like to read different commentaries to see from the smart people, you know, what their opinions are and pray about what God's wanting to talk about. And this one commentary I was reading, I won't read it anymore, said that just out of coincidence, Paul picked out pieces of the Roman army soldier and just applied something to it. I said, "Are you kidding me? If I believe that God's word is divinely inspired, written by man, but inspired by the word of God, all the way down to the last jot and tittle, brother, I'm telling you what, Paul did not do this by circumstance. It was divinely inspired by God that the belt of truth was supposed to be the belt of truth." Now, it says, "Gird up your loins." I'm going to teach you something right here. This is a thing that they would do because whenever you get ready to go into battle, you need to be able to fight. You need to be able to move those legs. You need to be able to run in case you need to run. Okay? What they would do, a lot of people would have a longer inner tunic inside their inner garment. And what you would do is this. I was going to bring a sheet and show you today, and I forgot. I was so excited. But they would reach back and grab the back part of their skirt or their tunic, and they would pull it up. And what that does is make like a pair of shorts on that individual. So they pull that up so that it was up above their knees, and then they would take a belt and cinch that in so that they could have freedom to fight or to flee. They call that the belt of truth because that's where it starts. You see, you have to tie up all the loose ends. You know, when I tuck in my shirt, I've lost a little bit of weight. And I started tucking my shirt, and I move all the excess to the back, you know, because, well, you can see. I've lost a little bit. Okay. Yeah, praise the Lord. Yeah, diabetic. Okay. Yeah, well, drink some water. Okay. Anyway. All the nurses in here are getting on me. All right. Anyway. So here's the deal. Tie up all the loose ends so you can't grab that loose piece. Do you know in football they actually use spray tack on the jersey so that they put it on so tight that you can't grab hold of them when they're running? Did you know that? And then that way they slide the shoulder pads, already got the shirt on, so that they can't grab you as you're running. I'm teaching you something right here, guys. I'm teaching you, especially linemen. You need that because they'll grab you right here. Okay? Spray that on there. That's how you, because when you go into battle, you don't want to reach out and grab you. So you put that belt of truth on. Put that belt of truth on. Take your Bibles, turn to John chapter 14. John chapter 14, verse 6. John chapter 14, verse 6. Look what it says here. Jesus is talking, and this is what he says. Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the," what was that? Truth. "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one, does that mean someone's got a back door they can get into heaven? No one comes to the Father except through him. So, Jesus calls himself the truth. So when it comes to who you believe Jesus is, do you believe that he is Jesus Christ, Christ meaning Messiah, the Son of God, all right, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, and the living Savior? Is that what you believe? Is that what you believe? Because the next one on your outline, who you think Jesus is, must be the very cornerstone of your faith. It's got to be. And if Jesus Christ is not the Son of God who takes the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, then guess what? Your battle's already weakening. You got no armor to stand on. You better get used to having a defeated life. The next one on your outline. Jesus is not a way to heaven. He's the only way to heaven. Amen. And just like the belt of truth, you must start out by tying up all the loose ends. What do you mean, Pastor? All the loose ends of doubt. You got doubt in who Jesus is? You better tie that up. You better dig in and find out what you know. Yep. Hey, I tell you what. Is he resurrected, sitting at the right hand of God? Well, I don't know. You better find that out. You better dig into God's word. You need that workout. Get in and find out what you believe. You need to know it. You need to know what you know. And you need to know the truth. The truth. What do you mean, Pastor? The truth. If you do not believe that truth that Jesus Christ says what he is, then just like other religions, they believe, well, you know, I believe Jesus was a good prophet. They'll all acknowledge him because you know what? There's a little truth in every lie. And yeah, he was a good prophet. He was a good old guy. I'm telling you what, he was a good prophet. He was a good teacher by him. Well, I'm telling you what, his teachings were just amazing. Was he the Son of God? Well, I don't know. Was he crucified on a cross? Yeah, there's plenty of proof to that. Did he resurrect? I kind of think so, but in the back of my mind, I'm kind of wondering, did anyone come back to life after that? What? Hey, you better dig in and do some work out and find out, for the truth is, he's alive. I'm not worshiping a dead Savior. He's the Savior of the world. Sitting at the right hand of the Father, and one day God's going to turn to him and say, go get my children. You better be ready. You better be ready. You cannot put your faith in anything else but Jesus Christ. It starts right there. You know what one of the biggest problems in the world today is? I'm going to tell you. Listen up. The world's going to tell you there's no absolute truth. Well, you know, truth's in the eye of the beholder. Well, I can tell you right now, you're getting ready to see a lot of reasons why no one believes anything anymore, and everyone wants to go to the show me state. Election year. We're doing the right thing. You need to vote for us. What we're telling you is the truth. Oh, that's hogwash. You need to vote for us. What's the truth over here? Both of you can't tell the truth if you happen to live for it. What the truth is to one person may not be to another person. The absolute truth. The divinely inspired, inerrant, infallible Word of God. And when I believe Jesus says, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, then by golly, I believe it 100%. And if not, my building that I'm building my relationship on, the cornerstone, is already sinking sand. The different religions argue about what the truth really is. The different religions. Hindus. In college I had a Hindu English professor. Boy, we like to jab everyone. She told me one time, "Oh, Tony, I'm sorry. It just happens. Forgive me, Lord. If anyone's from India, I'm sorry. It's just me. I told you, if the Lord can use me, he can use you, okay? I'm embarrassed right now. I'm sorry. The confession's very good for Jessica's laughing. I'll have her laughing the rest of the day. She'll be thinking about that, okay? But I can't hardly do it without doing it. Because I was trying to repeat after her, please, Lord, help me say it straight. She goes, Tony, do you think you got it right this time? She's talking about reincarnation. And I said, I had it right the first time. How about you? I still got an A. Still got an A. She might have liked that. I don't know. Miss Kazbaker, anybody I've heard? Went to Ohio University. I took some of my classes over there. You had her? Okay. She's funny. So, yeah. I'm not trying to be. It just happens. Ask my wife, okay? Take your Bible. It all started years and years ago. Take your Bibles. Turn to Genesis. Go to the very front of the book. Go to the very front of the book. Very front of the book. Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. I want you to see something right here. Genesis chapter 3, we're going to read verses 1 through 6. 1 through 6. Look what it says. Now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, here it comes, indeed has God said, you shall not eat from the tree of the garden. The woman said to the serpent, from the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat. But from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat from it or touch it. or touch it, or you will die. The serpent said to the woman, you surely will not die, for God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Now, I added verse 6 on here, because I want to read it. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate. And she gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. You see, it all started out this way. The serpent, the crafty devil, the schemes of the devil. The devil said, did God really say that? And notice, we're going to read where this was given from God to Adam. It was given to God to Adam. Eve hadn't been made yet. But God tells something, and we're not sure, but she added something to it. She twisted the truth. And I'll show you what I mean. Look at Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. Look what it says here. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it. The Lord God commanded the man, saying, from any, remember he talked just to Adam, from any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day, notice it doesn't say anything about nor touch. It just says, if you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it, you will surely die. Scheme of the devil. From the beginning of time was to question God. The same thing happens in your life, I bet, all the time. And what I mean is this. She saw the fruit. It was pleasing to the eyes. We read that. And she desired it in her heart. And what happens is the world is going to offer all kinds of things. And Satan's going to say, is it really that bad for a Christian to do that? Is that really what God's word says? Because we're not working out, we're not ready to fight the battle. And so what happens is, in our minds, because it was pleasing to the eye, we go, well, you know what? I think it's going to be okay. And then we cave in and we step over the boundary of what God has put there so that we can have a victorious Christian life, so we can live a life of joy. And we step over that boundary, we allow sin to come into our lives, and we're already defeated. I'm trying to learn you something. Know the truth. Know the truth. The truth will set you free. The truth will set you free. Now, we're not exactly sure, ladies. I don't want you to go home and talk to your husband and your boyfriend or whoever and say, you see? And the husband going, hey, but the woman ruined it. Even Adam said that to God. It's the woman you gave me. Maybe Adam didn't tell her the full truth. Maybe he goes, I'm going to try to keep you from shopping. Just don't touch it. Can't eat it, don't touch it. I don't know. But God had held Adam accountable. Because men, you should be that spiritual leader in your family. You must start out knowing what you know, what you know, what you know, and know the truth. The truth is that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And if you want to spend eternity in heaven, like he said, you got to go through him. Matthew. Go to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16. Oh, this is where I added the extra verse. I'm sorry. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he was asking his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? Look up here just real quick. People are still asking the same thing. Some believe he's a prophet. Some believe he's a teacher. Some people think he was crazy. He's just a lunatic. Verse 14. And they said, some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, but still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. Jesus said to them, but who do you say that I am? I added verse 16. Look at verse 16. Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of God. Of the living God. That's the question I'm asking you today. That's the question I'm asking you today, right now, this very moment. Who do you say that Jesus Christ is? If the answer is anything other than the Messiah, the Savior of the world, then we need to talk. Because I want to show you the truth. And I'm praying that the Holy Spirit speaks the truth into your life so that your brain and your heart knows that he is the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. I want you to know that. I want you to be able to say those words. I want you to stand on that. I want that to be your cornerstone of your faith in the living Lord Jesus Christ is the Messiah. That needs to happen. If I cannot believe that that is the truth, then how am I going to get to heaven? What about when Jesus says, hey, I'm going to give you peace, not as the world gives, but I'm going to give you peace that surpasses all understanding. I was in a barbershop this week, and the barber had a guy that was preaching to him. The whole time, I was just quiet. He just kept preaching. He thought he had me preaching. He's preaching to me. I'm not saying anything. He's cut my hair. And finally, he got done because this guy goes, I got no peace. I got no peace in life. I reached up behind him. I said, hi, my name is Reverend Tony Lambert. He goes, praise the Lord. And he goes, oh, my, I got goosebumps all over me. I got two of you in here. If I can't trust that he's the Savior of the world, then how can I trust that he's going to give me peace? And if I can't trust that he's the truth and the way, and he's not going to give me peace, then how am I going to win the battle? You see, it all starts by tying up the loose ends. You need to know who Jesus Christ is. He's the truth. He is. And the last one on your outline, the last line on your outline, there is no way that you can take on Satan and his schemes if you are not wrapped in the salvation of Jesus Christ wearing the belt of truth. No way. There's no way that you're ready to go into this world and fight the battle unless you have on that belt of truth. You're not ready, but you can be. In a moment, we're going to give him an invitation. I'm going to invite you. If you do not know the truth, When I say the truth, I mean Jesus Christ. If you do not know Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask you to come down the aisle. Just come down and say, Pastor, I want to trust Jesus Christ today. I'm tired of living a defeated life. And I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. The schemes of the devil. Are you ready? Satan's going to say, you don't need to go forward today. You've got it. You don't know the truth. You'll find the truth next week or the week after or the week after. And that first step's going to be so hard. You're going to have the white knuckle effect. You're going to grab hold of that chair in front of you. And Satan's going to say, do you think there's no other way to heaven? Come on, man. Either he's telling the truth or he's a liar. He is the truth. Maybe you're looking for a church home. We'd love to have you serve here. God's done some amazing things here. It's been exciting. And I know he's working in your life. We'd love to have you serve right here. Just come forward and say, hey, Pastor, I want to join this church. We accept you several ways. One is by a letter from a sister church. If you've been baptized by immersion, you can come and be a part of our church. By baptism, if you've been never been baptized by immersion, we can take care of that. Behind that wall, there's a baptistry. We'll be dunking again next week and the next week and the next week and the next week. Our statement saying, hey, I've trusted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I have been baptized, but it was a church somewhere far away, and I'm just coming on statement. You can do that as well. We'd love to have you serve right here. You know we need people. We've got a lot of things going on. You could be one of them. Maybe we'll come to the altar and pray and say, you know what? I need that truth cinched up a little tighter. I need to get rid of all those loose ends so that I'm ready to take on the battle. Let's pray. Father God, I come to you right now to thank you so much for your word and how it speaks to us. And God, as we have looked at trying to stand firm, we know we may struggle from time to time. But God, we know that we're not fighting for victory. We're fighting from victory. So God, I'm asking that you would just give us strength. For those who need to make a decision today, give them strength to take that first step. Father, for those looking for a church home, give them strength to make that first step. God, right now, I believe your word will not turn void. If there's anyone who needs to make a decision, I'm praying that your spirit will move in their heart to make that decision today. To bring glory and honor to you and to you alone, God. Nobody else. It's not about real joy. It's not about any other church. God, it is about you and only you. Business one-on-one with you. God, give us the strength today. Whatever decision it is, move in our hearts, stirred. Father God, we love you. We thank you. We ask us in Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand?